They've been called the Texas Kingmakers. They're the biggest political force in the Lone Star State. They won their marquee issue some 20 years ago, but even today, they bring in more money from big business interests than anyone to impact Texas politics. So what kind of impact are they making? They were behind the push to get rid of the Attorney General of Texas. Despite ostensibly being, quote, Republican, they protect the practice of giving committee chairmanships to Democrats in the GOP-dominated Texas House. In protecting the status quo, they've quietly weakened pro-life laws and undermined reforms designed to protect children from abuse. In campaigns, their spending dwarfs everyone else. But at the Capitol, they operate in the shadows. Once outsiders, they've become the consummate political establishment. And most Texans have no idea who they are, what they want, or even that they exist.
They've done enough damage over the last couple of years, and it's time for them to do something different.
There's a certain amount of hubris that goes along. Once you acquire this power and status, you want to maintain this power and status.
Even for native Texans and longtime political observers, it's difficult to imagine just how different Texas was politically and legally in the 1980s and 1990s. Today, everyone talks about the Texas miracle, the top business climate, the strong economy, the thriving hub of entrepreneurship. In the popular imagination, Texas is a free market haven. Texas is America's America. Today, Texas is a red state, firmly Republican. But in the Texas of the 1980s and 1990s, the Democrats ran things. Yes, change was in the air, but it hadn't happened yet. In less than 10 years, everything changed. Historically, the state had low taxes compared to the rest of the nation, and Texas had a fairly common sense regulatory environment, again, compared to the rest of the country. What we didn't have, what was the linchpin to it all, was a predictable legal environment. Lawsuit abuse was out of control. The Democrat political establishment was a wholly owned subsidiary of the plaintiff's bar. It was known as a judicial hellhole. It was so bad that even 60 Minutes took notice.
Is justice for sale in Texas? Some recent headlines might make you wonder. The Wall Street Journal has called the decision of one Texas court a national embarrassment. The New York Times editorialized that the conduct of the Texas courts is reminiscent of what passes for justice in small countries run by colonels in mirrored sunglasses.
What went mostly unmentioned in that 1987 feature story was that everyone mentioned, the big dollar political financier Joe Jamel, the embarrassing judges, all of them were Democrats.
By the end of the 80s, Texas had a full-blown emergency going on in its civil justice system.
Frankly, Texas's political, legal, and economic landscape was more reminiscent of a third-world country than the thriving model economy we think of today. Texas needed heroes.
When we first started, my goal was to stop the outrageous abuses that were currently going on and to restore the integrity of the law. That was it.
As opposed to being the Texas miracle, which people look at Texas now, it was really the Texas disaster. I heard all this data and said, this is crazy. So then I talked to a bunch of my colleagues. I said, are you having these problems? And everybody started, you know, saying they had incredible problems, started telling stories. And so I had a meeting of about 60 guys and to hear these stories, and the stories kept coming out, and I said, we need to go fix it. And everybody laughed and said, no, you can't fix it. The plaintiff trial is on the legislature, on a lot of the courts. No way to fix it. And I said, this is nuts.
That's Dick Weekly. He founded Texans for Lawsuit Reform in 1994 with a fellow Houston businessman named Dick Trabolsi, who was a player in Democrat politics, including doing time with the Jimmy Carter presidential campaign. They launched TLR as a bipartisan effort to get the civil justice system under control. And they did so just as the owner of the Texas Rangers baseball team was making tort reform a key issue in the 1994 gubernatorial campaign.
Texans are beginning to understand that when I'm the governor, I will propose meaningful tort reform to free our producers and entrepreneurs and providers from the clutches of the unjust tort system that threatens us in our society.
But as Weekly said, no one was confused about the likelihood for success. The plaintiff's bar was the 600-pound gorilla in Texas. Because of the massive riches generated by frivolous lawsuits for the plaintiff's lawyers in Texas, they were the undisputed political establishment. Democrats had solid locks on the Texas Senate and the Texas House. Ann Richards was the sitting governor. Remember her? A few years earlier, she'd given the keynote address at the Democrats' 1988 National Convention, where she slammed then-Vice President George H.W. Bush.
Poor George. He can't help it. He was born with a silver foot in his mouth.
Shockingly, George W. went on to win that 1994 gubernatorial race, even though the Senate and House remained under the sway of the Democrats, but not for long.
So we went to the legislature and we proposed 8 bills, which again, everybody laughed at, said he ever passed any of them. We ended up passing all 8 of them.
The political establishment in Texas had just been upended and the shockwaves would continue. Republicans took the Texas Senate in the 1996 election and then the Texas House in 2002. One of those incoming freshman House members in 2002 was Collin County Republican Ken Paxton, a lawyer who'd seen firsthand how badly the tort environment was tilted in favor of costly, frivolous lawsuits.
I'd say after I finished law school and came back to Texas from the University of Virginia, I had a pretty good feel that things were not right and that it was affecting people's ability to do business in an effective way in Texas.
Is it fair to say that lawsuit abuse was out of control in Texas?
I think it was. I mean, there's a balance here of access to the court and fairness. And it's hard to get it exactly right. I don't think necessarily anybody's gotten it exactly right because you can easily go too far and cut off access to the court and people can't get there and can't afford to go there. And then it gives big corporations a huge advantage. But also there ought to be some fairness to it so that, you know, if you're a corporation, you're not dissuaded from doing business in Texas because the laws are so arduous and difficult to deal with, you just leave.
As a single issue group, TLR was aggressively bipartisan. Here's how Dick Weekly explained their operations.
We support pro-business Democrats today in the legislature that will have the courage to vote with their constituents and stand up for the plaintiff trial lawyers who are trying to threaten them with primary opponents.
By the start of that legislative session in 2003, the battle lines were clear.
Pretty much tort reformers versus the plaintiff's bar was a surrogate for Republicans versus Democrats. And that's certainly the way I understood it. And I think most people understood it.
Mark Pulliam was a lawyer working in California at the time, where he was involved in tort reform efforts. He moved home to Texas in part because of the economic environment that was created by the tort reform winds of 1995 through 2003.
A dysfunctional civil justice system is not attractive to the business community. And you see how Texas has been flooded with large national companies, big tech. A lot of what those people, you know, were attracted by was a sensible civil justice system. And TLR, I think, can, you know, crown itself with the laurel that they are responsible for taking a legal system that had been controlled by Joe Gemayel and his ilk and turning it into the model. And I have been very forthright about, pointing this out.
Well, first off, I am a proud Texan. We do not chase lawsuits. No, we do not chase lawsuits.
The group that has been transformative for decades now in ensuring that Texas has the right business climate, and that is Texans for Lawsuit Reform.
History tells us that when conquering heroes returned to Rome, they would be honored with a parade in which all of the citizens would turn out. The general would ride in a special chariot, cheered by everyone for his great deeds. Riding with him would be a slave, placed there by the Roman Senate, whispering repeatedly, "Remember, you are just a man." The Roman Senate worried victory and adoration would inspire someone to believe their own PR and become a dictator. They were right. By the early days of the 21st century, the judicial hellhole known as Texas had become a national model for tort reform. Victory had been secured. I sat down with Trey Traynor, a Texas lawyer appointed to the Federal Elections Commission by Donald Trump. He'd worked in the legislature in the late 1990s and early 2000s. How important politically and economically was tort reform and has tort reform been to Texas?
I think politically and economically, it's one of the things that led to the continued rise of the Republican Party in the state and allowed for a full takeover of all of the statewide offices. That was one of the key issues. As you mentioned, Governor Bush made it a platform plank, and so it was something that was pushed very heavily by Republicans across the board. Ultimately allowed us to, again, one of the planks to take over leadership of the House.
But by the end of the first decade of the 2000s, TLR had accomplished all of its stated goals. The plaintiff's bar was a shell of its former self, and the business environment was thriving. Also thriving was TLR. Mark Pulliam told me that one of the first things he did when he moved to Texas was call TLR and offer them his support and services, joining their speakers bureau and becoming a donor.
Nobody is going to write a check to for a mission that has been unsuccessful. So they got the job done, and they were brilliant in celebrating and promoting their role in that success. And I would occasionally get into arguments with my conservative activist friends in Texas when I would tell them that, I am on board with TLR and I am speaking on their behalf. And they would say, "Don't you know that they support liberal Democrats?" And I would say, "Well, only because those liberal Democrats have signed on to their agenda. And when you're a single issue group, you take your supporters where you find them. And that's one of the reasons that they're effective, is that they don't get bogged down in this partisan battles, that they're surgical. They're interested in the one issue, and they have their army, and they get the job done." You could say that maybe once this big job got done, that they could have gone back to something short of a standing army, a peacekeeping force. But I think there's a certain amount of hubris that goes along. Once you acquire this power and status, you want to maintain this power and status. And eventually, they sort of ran out of tort issues to solve.
The issue itself, I think, had played out. I think they had won, and in most cases, you would declare victory and go home. In Texas for Lawsuit Reform's case, looking at it, they are now like most lobby organizations. If they win on their issue, they look for the next big issue and try to morph themselves into something that's there because they want to keep the money flowing to the lobbyists that work for the organization. And it's in the interest of the legislators to do that as well. They'll squint and glean to say that this looks like their issue, so we'll call it that way because they're the ones who end up ultimately with the money.
I should note here that we repeatedly tried to get Dick Weekly and Dick Tribolsi to sit down for interviews to talk about TLR's past, present, and future. They didn't respond. With all that money and access, TLR decided they would morph. Here's TLR founder Dick Weekly from an interview he gave several years ago.
The organization has evolved from just tort reform to being really kind of pro-business.
Pro-business. That's a curious descriptor. Most conservatives will talk about being in favor of free markets or capitalism. TLR, though, is pro-business. Pro-business is usually a euphemism for protectionist policies in which big businesses collude with the government to erect barriers for small businesses to compete in the marketplace.
I've been involved in politics and working to try to improve the community through public service for a long time.
And you've been involved with Chamber of Commerce?
Yes, Chamber of Commerce, a lot of other business organizations and associations.
When the legislature is seated in 2025, Brent Money will be a member of the Texas House after a bruising fight. A city councilman, Chamber of Commerce guy, whose legal practice focused on helping small businesses avoid the kind of lawsuits TLR claims to hate.
No one was a bigger detractor of Brent Money than Texans for Lawsuit Reform. Spent close to $1 million.
Close to a million.
Between special election runoff, and then the primary. Did it surprise you that this Houston-Austin lobby group was coming after you?
No, I think it shocked me. I really thought that I would be the kind of consensus candidate that the Christian conservatives could rally around, because I am a strong Christian conservative and care about those cultural issues. But at the same time, I've been in public life long enough, and I've served my community and my clients in such a way that I really thought that an organization like TLR would be happy to have someone like that advocating for their agenda, whatever that may be, in the state legislature.
Whatever that agenda might be indeed, it's hard to know what their agenda is. Brady Gray heads the Texas Family Project.
Everything we kept hearing in legislators' office, from legislators, from staff, from different stakeholders within the Capitol, everything we kept hearing was TLR doesn't want this to go. TLR doesn't like this bill. They don't want this to pass.
Brady was talking about children who are forced into surgical and chemical sterilization as part of the transgender movement, and giving them the ability, once they're an adult, to hold doctors and others legally responsible for the actions done to them.
My name is Chloe Cole, and I am a detransitioner. Another way to put that would be, I used to believe that I was born the wrong body, and the adults in my life whom I trusted affirmed my belief, and this caused me lifelong irreversible harm. I speak to you today as a victim of one of the biggest medical scandals in the history of the United States of America. I speak to you in the hope that you will have the courage to bring the scandal to an end and ensure that other vulnerable teenagers, children, and young adults don't go through what I went through.
You won't find anything about this issue on TLR's website.
It is interesting the amount of power that a single organization can have, that they don't even have to make a public statement. They don't have to come out and publicly say or put out any statements against something. Those legislators knew, that staff knew, people knew in the Capitol, no, this doesn't happen because this organization doesn't want it to happen.
Did any of them give you a reason why TLR didn't want to happen?
Never got a clear reason why, but beyond even just the legislation, it wasn't just that bill. It was the concept in general.
None of that is news to Dr. John Sego, who heads Texas Right to Life.
They're very good at not having fingerprints. The majority of where I've seen them have an impact on my bills, you know, pro-life bills, bills that save lives, it has been negative.
Where they do leave fingerprints is in elections. In 2022, TLR was the largest donor to a Democrat in an open state Senate seat that was widely considered a swing seat. They supported the Democrat instead of the Republican challenger. The Democrat won by less than 1% of the vote.
When did it happen that TLR started working against conservatives in the Republican primaries?
It's been a slow
sort of transition away from focusing on keeping good conservatives in office to playing more with the Democratic side of the equation and dealing with issues that necessarily conservatives might actually oppose, and trying to do things now that we, people that I know that care about Texas and that are conservative, would not necessarily appreciate Texans for lawsuit doing.
No issue has galvanized Republican donors and conservative activists like the practice of Democrats being appointed to chair powerful committees inside the Texas legislature. Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick has put an end to the practice in the Texas Senate, but Republicans in the House, most notably Speaker Dade Phelan, well, they've continued to embrace it.
Would you continue that practice if you are reelected Speaker?
I'm not wavering from that.
In the 2022 primary, more than 80% of Republican primary voters, that's nearly 1.6 million voters, said they wanted the practice ended. It turns out Democrats wanting power in the legislature have big Republican money backing them.
One example that comes to mind is a friend of mine who is a conservative running for the legislature in an open seat. And in open seats, right, any group can support anybody. They're all kind of Republicans. They all say they're conservative.
Luke Macias hosts a podcast with Texas Scorecard, and he works as a political strategist.
So this guy walks in to meet with Texans for Lawsuit Reform for an interview. And he's thinking the questions he's going to get are, what do you think about lawsuit reform? Have you ever been in a lawsuit? And I've been in these interviews with candidates before. Have you ever been in a lawsuit? Have you ever sued anybody? What's your business? What kind of business? You know, and they'll talk about different industries and how they've protected those industries with their policy. And the first question they ask him, he sits down and they go, what do you think about Democrat chairs? Odd question.
Wait, that's the first question?
First question they ask. What do you think about Democrat chairs?
What does it have to do with tort reform?
And that's what you'd have to ask that question, right? Because if Democrats were chairing all the committees that they need policy through, you know what would happen? Like, their policy would die. In fact, we've seen that happen in the past, right? Where the insurance committee was specifically, certain people were put over these committees that made it harder for TLR to get their agenda through. They know the pain that comes with somebody who's chairing a committee who doesn't agree with you. So the question is, why protect Democrat chairs? Why take this position that says we support Democrat chairs? They tell candidates, by the way, precisely, we support Democrat chairs.
What possible reason is there for TLR to have that as their first question?
It doesn't fit their mission statement at all. It doesn't fit anything that they say they're for. This is what they do behind the scenes, which is antithetical to what they are actually saying they are about. And this is part of my problems. They're duplicitous and they're dishonest about what they actually are trying to do. They're trying to help Dade Phelan keep control, and they're helping the Democrats who control the Texas House, who control the Speaker. They're trying to help their cause. That's the only reason you would ask that question.
They might as well come out and say, do you or don't you support the platform of the Republican Party and you're running as a Republican? I mean, that's ultimately what that question means.
Does that shock you that TLR, ostensibly a Republican organization, would be intent on protecting Democrat chairs?
Well, Michael, I'll just tell you, it would have shocked me a year ago. That shocks me this much today. And now that I know more about how Austin works, you start to understand that TLR views those Democrat chairs as useful to kill the bills that they don't want. And so if you are able to be placed into a position of power and called upon by TLR for some purpose at some point in time, they probably find Democrat chairs useful. It's probably a good explanation for why TLR-backed candidates in these primaries were saying Democrat chairs are actually a good thing.
Mitch Little will be entering the Texas House in 2025 after having defeated incumbent Kronda Timich in the 2024 GOP primary. She was endorsed by Dade Phelan, Greg Abbott, and she received massive support from TLR. How massive? To the tune of a couple million dollars.
When the money starts flowing in, this is money that's been raised from a lot of businesswomen from around the state who think that they are contributing to an organization that exists to promote business interests.
Sure.
How many of those folks do you think intended for their money to be used to go after a conservative candidate who is challenging, who by most reports was at best a moderate, possibly even a edging left of center incumbent? How do you think those folks feel about that?
I don't think they had a clue, Michael.
Like many challengers to establishment candidates in the 2024 election cycle, TLR didn't even try to interview Mitch Little. Now, there's probably a couple reasons for that. A big elephant in the room we haven't yet discussed in the story. We'll get to that. And we'll come back to what donors to TLR do and do not know. Luke Macias made a really important observation about TLR's views on Democrats chairing House committees.
Now, what they don't say is, we want Democrats to chair the committees that we need to see legislation go through, right? So why protect it? Because it's the existing regime. And the existing regime serves their interests well. They are still able to notch a handful of legislative victories out every single session. And they believe that the way you, as an influential PAC and nonprofit organization, influence, keep that level of influence of the legislature is to endorse the behavior of the legislature.
I think there is a crony capitalist lobby in Austin that is designed to limit volatility of outcome. And so the billionaires can stay billionaires. Their business isn't affected. It doesn't matter if there are children being sex trafficked across the border. It doesn't matter if, you know, one or more lives aren't preserved through pro-life efforts. Their central concern is limiting volatility of outcomes.
Since TLR operatives wouldn't answer questions, we thought we'd talk to TLR's rank-and-file donors about their experiences. We wanted to ask them their thoughts about TLR money being used to undermine conservative priorities in the legislature to fight against conservatives on the campaign trails. No one was really eager to go on the record for fear of retribution from Dick Weekly, Dick Tribolsi, and others at TLR. For some, there was concern about TLR loyalists withdrawing funding for organizations with which they're involved. Still others worried about TLR going behind the scenes to kill legislative priorities. And then there were those who mentioned concerns about business and social pressure. But some were willing to talk off the record.
I couldn't get answers for why the tort reform people were so eager to have Democrats chairing committees in the House.
I was sold on TLR because they promised to be analytical in their political work to achieve. And instead, I saw nothing but personal animus driving their decisions.
And it was that personal animus that went on full display in 2022 and 2023 that attracted the most attention to TLR in more than three decades of operation. They couldn't hide their fingerprints.
Watching the Paxton primary made me angry. All the money I put into TLR was now being used to attack my candidate for attorney general on issues that had nothing to do with tort reform.
If you ask almost any Republican voter in Texas who is your favorite elected official, they'd say Ken Paxton. He's our champion. He's in there in the courts fighting for freedoms of Texans every day.
Bailiff can bring in the witness, please.
Did you also talk to Dick Tribolsi?
Not at that time, no.
How soon after that did you talk to Dick Tribolsi? You know who I'm talking about, don't you?
It's the
leader. Tell us who he is.
I believe he's the leader of Texans for Lawsuit Reform.
Long accustomed to working in the shadows in and around the Texas Capitol, a place where they usually left no fingerprints, suddenly, TLR's methods began to be seen during the impeachment of Ken Paxton. But this part of TLR's story doesn't actually start there.
When I ran for the House, they didn't know me, so they didn't support me. That to me was perfectly understandable. Now, 10 years later, I ran for the Texas Senate, and my voting record was clear. I voted with them 100% of the time. And yet they came to me after 10 years of supporting their positions and said, we're not supporting you for Texas Senate. We're going to support this guy that has no record. I thought that was rather strange, given the fact that I had been supportive of their cause. I went on and won that election. The guy ended up dropping out, but they were not helpful, and they have never been helpful since.
After 2011, TLR had settled comfortably into the role of being the 600-pound gorilla of Texas politics. The old 600-pound gorilla had been killed. The kingmakers and the plaintiff's bar were defeated.
Meet the new boss, same as the old boss.
Through the unmatched fundraising efforts of Dick Weekly, the war chest grew and grew. As has been noted, the public-facing agenda of TLR became more and more narrow. Where there were new openings for the plaintiff's bar to attack business interests, TLR was there. Here's how Mark Pulliam, the former TLR donor and Speakers Bureau member, put it.
You know, after they accomplished all of their big wins, they discovered in the wake of Hurricane Ike and some of these hailstorm incidents that homeowners carriers were being deluged with claims being instigated by the plaintiff's bar. And so they needed to come in and kind of fix that on a one-off basis. And so they really were the sort of the emergency room doctor when it came to civil justice. And I think you need an emergency room doctor, because it's something that you're never going to be completely fixed. You're always going to require attention here and there.
Meanwhile, Texas's new Attorney General Ken Paxton existed off to the side. Mainly, he was suing Barack Obama.
A lot.
His wife, Angela Paxton, even wrote a song about it.
I'm a pistol packing mama, yes I am. I'm a pistol packing mama, yes I am. I'm a pistol packing mama, and my husband sues Obama. I'm a pistol packing mama, yes I am.
But the threats to Texas didn't just come from Obama. Wall Street investment banks started undermining Texas energy producers, while big tech censored conservatives, and big pharma was getting a free pass from the feds.
When Ken Paxton started talking about going after Google and other big tech companies, I think that set off an alarm. And this is just my speculation, that these deep-pocketed donors who fund TLR are saying, we don't like him. He's, you know, he's too antagonistic towards our bread and butter. And so let's see if we can't get somebody else in there who will, you know, be tort reformers, but who will also be more congenial to the rest of our policy agenda.
Who TLR found was Eva Guzman, a moderate member of the Texas Supreme Court.
Former Texas Supreme Court Justice Eva Guzman has officially launched her campaign for state attorney general.
It should be noted here that Ken Paxton was not the only pro-tort reform statewide incumbent that TLR targeted for defeat because of his willingness to upset the establishment apple cart and a perceived affiliation with the grassroots and social conservatives. In the same year they went after Paxton, TLR sought to remove Texas Agriculture Commissioner Sid Miller from office. He'd been a reliable ally of TLR through his tenure in the Texas House and then won the open seat race for Ag Commissioner in 2014. Mr. Miller had brushed off two primary challengers in 2018 and then won the general election by 5 percentage points. But in 2022, inexplicably, TLR engaged against him for re-election. They instead endorsed James White, also a former member of the Texas House. In fact, they made up more than half of Mr. White's funding for the 2022 primary.
You're given to a group that says, we're here to prevent frivolous lawsuits, that then take your money and spend a bunch of it trying to unseat the sitting agriculture commissioner, Sid Miller. Like, that doesn't make sense, right? Did Sid Miller engage in frivolous lawsuits at the Texas Department of Agriculture? Is he pushing different rulemaking that's opening farmers up to frivolous lawsuits in the courts?
no.
TLR never provided a reason for backing White over Miller. Political observers say TLR just decided they wanted their man, who was backed by one of their in-house consultants, to hold statewide office. One source inside TLR told me off the record that the leadership just didn't like Miller's affiliation with social conservatives, and they really didn't like his close relationship with Donald Trump. Voters, it turned out, really liked Sid Miller and kept him in the post. But the Paxton race in that same year and TLR's involvement overshadowed everything else.
So there was a sense that he was too cozy with President Trump and with Trump supporters. I think the derangement set in, and pretty soon you have him, you know, rifling through, like, who do we have here that we can, you know, use to take out Ken Paxton? That he's just become too grassroots friendly, and he's no longer attuned to our agenda.
While TLR spent $250,000 trying to unseat Miller, they spent a lot more trying to beat Ken Paxton.
Would it surprise you to learn that TLR in 2022 spent $3.1 million against you, and then some of their top folks spent in excess of $4 million opposing you in 2022?
No, I'm very aware that money was spent. I felt it. And it made things obviously more challenging when you spend that kind of money. There's an impact to it. So yes, I'm very aware that TLR decided that I was not their candidate for attorney general, and they recruited people and they spent a lot of money to get them elected. They didn't do very well, but they did try.
Didn't do very well is putting it lightly. In the four-way race, TLR did manage to push Paxton into a runoff, but not with their candidate. Their candidate was former Supreme Court Justice Eva Guzman, who pulled a distant third behind Ken Paxton and George P. Bush.
This move that they made of opposing Paxton, presumably encouraging her to resign her seat on the Texas Supreme Court, and then spending a lot of money in support of her candidacy, which she barely outpolled Louis Gohmert, who got into the race at the last minute, it all seemed kind of amateurish almost. And the one thing you could never say about TLR was that they were amateurs.
In that runoff against George P. Bush, Paxton received 68% of the vote. But TLR wasn't done, not by a long shot.
Can we agree that you were texting Nate Paul about Dick Weekly?
That is what the text messages show, yes.
Can we agree that you delivered to Nate Paul information about an event Dick Weekly was holding because Dick Weekly was trying to get Nate Paul to donate money to Texans for lawsuit reform?
No, sir.
You don't remember that?
No, sir, I do not.
Can we agree that that text that you're holding in your hand confirms that you were texting information about Dick Weekly to Nate Paul?
It does.
In 2020, disgruntled members of Ken Paxton's staff organized a slow-motion coup. In the middle of their efforts was TLR. The whistleblower's allegations, which were disproven at a trial in the Texas Senate, were the basis for the secret House investigation and rushed impeachment vote in the House on Memorial Day weekend 2023. What no one knew in May of 2023 was just how involved TLR's leadership had been in that effort. Paxton's legal team knew, which included Mitch Little.
It was well known in the summer of 2023 that Texans for Lawsuit Reform was one of the animators of the impeachment.
Of course, TLR loudly denied any participation. They were confident in their ability to leave no fingerprints. Ironically, their role became widely exposed when they did the one thing TLR never does. They pushed for a trial. Paxton's attorneys had asked the Senate to simply dismiss the charges. TLR demanded that a trial proceed. They got their wish.
It was also very well known at that point in time that some of the quote-unquote whistleblowers in the impeachment had contacts with Dick Trabalsi at Texans for Lawsuit Reform. We saw them. We saw them in the correspondence. We understood that that was something that had gone on.
In writing an article for The Federalist, Mark Pulliam came across correspondence which included emails between TLR's Dick Trabulsi and political commentator Karl Rove. Their exchange dealt with an inflammatory op-ed that eventually appeared in the Wall Street Journal under the name of Texas's former governor Rick Perry, calling for the impeachment of Mr. Paxton.
This op-ed apparently was not written by Rick Perry after all. It was apparently written by Karl Rove and placed in the Wall Street Journal through the auspices of the TLR Communications Department. And there's a trail of emails, including some emails back and forth between Karl Rove and Dick Trabulsi, showing that, or at least appearing to show that. I have not received any requests for retraction or correction or any pushback whatsoever, I think because it's true. This is the way it happened. And so the idea that TLR, after it made what I consider to be a ill-conceived political judgment to take out Ken Paxton, after spending millions of dollars, wasting millions of dollars of their donors' money, pushing Eva Guzman, instead of respecting the wishes of the electorate, to then use more of their resources to surreptitiously, you know, put these phony op-eds in the Wall Street Journal trying to undermine Ken Paxton while the Senate was deliberating, that has nothing to do with promoting tort reform. That has nothing to do with fighting to preserve the Texas miracle. That's just rhino politics.
TLR was the political engineer of the Paxton impeachment. They are the political engine that drove the impeachment. Karl Rove wouldn't have been able to accomplish it on his own, certainly not Rick Perry either. TLR had the financial wherewithal, the political clout, and the personnel in the House necessary to make the impeachment come off.
Were you surprised by how involved TLR was with the whistleblowers and then on into impeachment?
No, I realized they lost an election. They spent a lot of money. It was embarrassing to them how much they spent and the fact that they supported somebody that got third place, almost last place, with a lot of money and a lot of their effort. So they, instead of making things good with me and trying to work things out for the future, they decided, no, let's work on this internal plot. Let's do everything we can to take them out another way. The voters have spoken, but we don't believe in what the voters have said, and we're going to try to overrule that.
Did that surprise you that you had TLR, Karl Rove, and Rick Perry trying to undermine you ahead of the trial in the Texas Senate?
No, it just played right into what they had been doing in the past. It was an organization that had been working, I think, for a very long time to try to figure out some way to beat me in either in a primary, a general. And they would have been happy with a general election loss. And then they could have said, oh, see, we were right. We didn't cause them to lose, but they would have caused me to lose. And they were happy to do that. But if that didn't work, let's try something internally. And then the legal system. And, you know, we'll try anything we have to. And clearly, Karl Rove, TLR, and some of these former employers were all working together to make this happen. And they still are.
Tony Busby was one of Ken Paxton's lawyers. In an interview ahead of the impeachment trial, he had this to say about TLR and Ken Paxton.
There's apparently a large rift in the Republican Party, the state of Texas. What we have in Texas right now is we have, I would call them the pro-business Republicans fighting the more ideological Republicans. And Texans for Lawsuit Reform is part of the pro-business Republicans. I mean, I'm just telling you what they claim they are.
I mean, I view myself as a business Republican. Now, I am, one of my constitutional roles is to make sure that corporations do not commit fraud. And so, you know, I think TLR would like to put that aside. If they commit fraud, I think TLR would say, that's fine. We don't, businesses are business. You know, we're going to—
A little fraud is good for business.
So, I mean, they have tried to change the law in different ways that affect my ability to go after corporate fraud. So I want as many businesses to come to Texas. I want them to have low taxes. I want them to have less regulation. I want them to have the opportunity to create jobs and wealth for Texans. So I am very pro-business. What I'm not for is fraud. And the things that TLR works now on, and this is why we are divergent, they come into the legislature and try to undo the attorney general's office to go after that fraud, whether it's through nuisance law or through the Deceptive Trade Practices Act. Those are our only tools.
At last count, TLR still has a war chest of $30 million.
That's a lot of money for, frankly, that's a lot of money for any group. And it's part of what I think that grassroots Texans despise most about politics these days.
So what's next?
They've done enough damage over the last couple of years, and it's time for them to do something different.
They've basically thrown in with the Democrats to undermine the voice of Republican voters who, you know, voted for conservative majorities in both houses, but aren't getting conservative policies because of this conscious decision to kneecap the conservatives in order to promote the hegemony of the, you know, of the establishment.
What should voters think when they look at the candidates on their ballot? I'm thinking for state rep, state senate, whatever the office might be, and they see that one of the candidates is backed by, supported by Texans for Lawsuit Reform.
I think she automatically knows a voter that that is not your state rep. He is controlled by Texans for Lawsuit Reform. He is not there to take care of you. He's not usually asking you for money. He's not usually asking for your vote, except through the auspices of Texans for Lawsuit Reform. So you are really empowering Texans for Lawsuit Reform when you support their candidates. You are giving them the control of the state. You as a constituent mean very little to Texans for Lawsuit Reform, and thus you mean very little to that state rep who's supported by Texans for Lawsuit Reform.
They spent $8 million trying to get rid of Ken Paxton. They spent at least $1 million trying to make sure that I don't get to the House. I have a lot of personal satisfaction knowing that those people woke up on Wednesday morning on March 6th and the world was different than it was on March 5th. And I think it's going to continue to be that way. It's the people who vote here, the people who care about the Republican legislative priorities, those are the people who matter. They matter a lot more today than they did on March 5th.
TLR has been called shrewd as a compliment. They promise donors to take personalities out of political giving. But in 2022, in 2024, TLR's political actions have seemed exceedingly personal. Donor after donor in private conversations told me that.
I was sold on TLR because they promised to be analytical in their political work to achieve. Instead, I saw nothing but personal animus driving their decisions. I'm done.
Even in the last week of my election, where if they had done any polling at all, they would have seen they were behind by double digits. President Trump had come and endorsed me on top of Abbott and Cruz and a bunch of other people. There was no turning that tide. And they came in and threw another $350,000 of someone's hard-earned money on top of what was already a losing battle. So it doesn't seem like the kind of investment I would want to make.
What advice would you give to a new donor to TLR, to a prospective donor? What kind of questions should they be asking about Texans for Lawsuit Reform?
Well, I would ask them to go back and account for how they spent their money in the last, say, 4 years. Why are you helping the Democrats control the Texas House? I would start asking the questions like, why are you so engaged in helping so many Democratic causes? And why are you so engaged in helping causes that are traditionally not conservative and certainly not Republican?
Well, I think you have to look at an organization's track record, not just what its stated principles are and what its original mission was, but what is it doing today? And if they've gotten off course, then, you know, before you decide I'm going to, you know, devote my treasure and talent to promoting this organization, is their mission consistent, their current actions consistent with their stated and original mission? And if not, then I would say find another organization to support.
I would just tell those donors, you know, you need to have, you know, longer conversations with TLR and with those who are supporting TLR of really, what are we trying to accomplish? What is their legislative agenda?
I think my ultimate question to them would be, what is your purpose? What's the purpose of TLR? Why do you exist? I think that's probably a question that they should answer.
I would say I came into this process with a very positive view of TLR and what they were trying to accomplish, and that has been dashed.
Texans for Lawsuit Reform was widely successful in fighting the political establishment. Now, they are the establishment. TLR was started to fight injustice, and now they allow injustice. Once a grassroots organization, TLR now works in opposition to the conservative grassroots majority in Texas. It's unclear why they exist anymore, except for the accumulation of power. I would have liked to have asked them about that. As Brady Gray reminded me in our conversation, power, for the sake of power, is evil. As I finished my conversation with Mitch Little, he made a very simple point. He said that after all the money TLR spent in his district, all the lies they allowed to be told about Mitch, he asked me if I knew how many votes they had in the district he'll be representing in 2025. The answer? Not a one.
TLR doesn't get to vote in my district.
As citizens in Texas, it's up to us to decide whose counsel our elected officials heed. Will they listen to you or the special interest lobbyists in Austin? It's up to us as citizens to ask them hard questions, and it's up to each of us as voters to hold them accountable for the answers. TLR or any of the other would-be kingmakers only have sway when we, as the voters, aren't doing our job. I can say this without any hubris. You and your fellow citizens are supposed to be in charge. Texas doesn't need kings or kingmakers. So what will your impact be?